So when it's not accidental, any of this, and I know it sounds like a bloody paranoid conspiracy theory, but you know, I've always been of the idea, especially from reading Jung, that ideas, people don't have ideas, ideas have people. And these are powerful ideas. And if you go on YouTube, where I'm radically overrepresented, and you look at the comments and the likes and the dislikes, it's about the same ratio. It's like likes to dislikes is like about 100 to 1, and almost all the comments are positive, which, you know, could easily be a selection bias and probably is, but, you know, it still means that there's quite a few people who think that what I'm doing is sort of okay as far as they're concerned, and so that's important. The people at the top are only there because they've stole everything from the people at the bottom. And so the Marxists in France realized that by the end of 1960s, thereabouts, when even Jean-Paul Sartre finally figured out that to be a communist probably wasn't acceptable, given that the bloody Soviets had killed like 30 million people between 1919 and 1959, and the Maoists had done the same thing on a greater scale in China, and then we could talk about North Korea, and we could talk about, you know, but whatever, you know, we don't, students don't learn any of that in school anymore, and even if they did, they wouldn't want to listen to it. When I tell my students in my second year psychology class about the Gulag Archipelago, hardly any of them know. Well, why is that? Well, it's because they haven't been taught it. Why is that? Well, see if you can figure it out. You often hear the radical leftists make about communism, about Marxism. They say, well, that wasn't real Marxism. It's like, okay, well, how many countries do you need to disprove your thesis? How many millions of people have to die before you might admit that you're wrong? Well, obviously more than 100 million, because that's the approximate total. That's probably an underestimate, but we'll be conservative, because adding another 10 million doesn't really make that much difference. One of the problems with postmodernism is that, and this is a big problem, like this is a fatal problem, apart from the fact that it's incoherent and there's no value structure in it, and it's fundamentally divisive and destructive. There's a logical problem with it too that's even worse. And so, okay, so here's a problem. There's a big problem here. The problem is, it's true. You're oppressed, you're oppressed, you're oppressed, you're oppressed. God only knows why. Maybe you're too short, or you're not as beautiful as you could be, or, you know, your parent, your grandparent was a serf, likely, because almost everybody's great-grandparent was. It's like, you know, and you're not as smart as you could be, and you have a sick relative, and you have your own physical problems, and it's like, frankly, you're a mess. And you're oppressed in every possible way, including your ancestry and your biology, and the entire sum of human history has conspired to produce victimized you with all your individual pathological problems. It's like, yes, true. Okay, but the problem is that it is true. And so if you take the oppressed, you have to fractionate them and fractionate them. It's like, I read a lot about the terrible things that people have done to each other. You just cannot even imagine it. It's so awful. So you don't want to be someone like that. Now, do you have a reason to be? Yes. You have lots of reasons to be. God, there's reasons to be resentful about your existence. Everyone you know is going to die. You know, you too. And there's going to be a fair bit of pain along the way. And lots of it's going to be unfair. It's like, yeah, no wonder you're resentful. It's like, act it out and see what happens. You make everything you're complaining about infinitely worse. So you think, well, what do you do about that? Well, you accept it. That's what life is like. It's suffering. That's what the religious people have always said. Life is suffering. Yes. Well, who wants to admit that? Well, just think about it. Well, so what do you do in the face of that suffering? Try to reduce it. Start with yourself. What good are you? Get yourself together, for Christ's sake, so that when your father dies, you're not whining away in a corner, and you can help plan the funeral, and you can stand up solidly so that people can rely on you. That's better. Don't be a damn victim. Of course you're a victim. Jesus. Obvious. Put yourself together. And then maybe if you put yourself together, you know how to do that. You know what's wrong with you, if you'll admit it. You know there's a few things you could, like, polish up a little bit, that you might even be able to manage in your insufficient present condition. And so you might shine yourself up a little bit, and then your eyes will be a little more open, and then you can shine yourself up a little bit more, and then maybe you could bring your family together instead of having them be the hateful, spiteful, neurotic, infighting batch that you're like doomed to spend Christmas with.